Hello. Welcome to my channel and yet another talk about Egypt. And if you're wondering why there is indeed another talk about Egypt, it's because my book, The Climax of Egypt, is just about finished. I'm handing it off to the publisher in a couple of days. So the whole subject is spinning around in my head, and it's much easier for me to do it at this point in time than it will be in 6 months. So here we go. This talk is about Tutankhamun. Unlike the previous talk I recorded, which was about Horemheb, who came second king after Tutankhamun, everybody, of course, has heard of Tutankhamun, even if they don't know very much about him. Quite obviously, the most famous king of Egypt, and perhaps one of the most famous figures from antiquity. But it is remarkable that even today, so little is known about him. But I just want to go back to just my own personal involvement, very limited, of course, but in 1972, I went to the British Museum exhibition in London, and I was about 14 years old when I went. And I have mentioned that on this channel before. It was a totally overwhelming experience. I mean, really quite mesmerising. Of course, I'd never been to Egypt at that age. In those days, people didn't travel very much in the way that they do today, or at least could before COVID hit. So it was a fantastically exotic experience to see this. I'd already read about it. The item that sticks out most in my mind, though, is not the famous golden mask, but the writing palette of Meriatarten, who was the eldest daughter of Akhenaten, the heretic pharaoh, and it was quite obviously a family heirloom that had ended up in the tomb. And I was just mesmerised by that object above all else, because there was this intimate, personal item which had survived completely unscathed because it was in that tomb. And therein lies the rub, doesn't it? But I still have the catalogue I bought at that time, incredibly, 49 years ago. And I am still totally overwhelmed by photographs like this, which were taken at the time when the tomb was discovered. Now, I know it's a famous photograph, but it still bears re-examining. If you look at the top there, you can see there's a stool balanced on top of a bed. I just can't get my head past the fact that it stayed balanced like that for 1,000 years by the time Alexander the Great invaded Egypt. And it was another 300 years before Augustus took Egypt into the Roman Empire. And that's just extraordinary, because we live in an ever-changing world. You know, the weather, erosion, people come and go, buildings are built, they fall down. But somehow this extraordinary deposit had survived throughout that period of time, essentially untouched, apart from the couple of robberies that took place shortly after the tomb was sealed. That length of time represents something like 160 generations of human beings, virtually all of whom have disappeared completely without trace, left no evidence of their existence whatsoever. And that will be true for most of us. It's incredibly humbling. But there is this remarkable instance of when Carter went in with Lord Carnarvon, they breathed the air of the 18th dynasty. The time machine of the tomb had just arrived. They're intact with all its objects, things that they knew about from pictures or broken fragments found in other tombs. And there it all was, cluttered, piled up. The ceremonial beds, the boxes, the calcite jars that had once been full of unguents, robbed by some of the thieves who'd broken into the tomb. They'd taken the unguents out. The chariots piled high in the corner, the model boats, the I suppose you could call it almost the tailor's dummy of Tutankhamun, the upper part of Tutankhamun's body with a bust and a headpiece on. And that was just designed, I think, to model Tutankhamun's clothes. And that's just parked in the corner, peering through the chariots. And one of the chariots even still has grease on its axles. All this paraphernalia of a royal tomb, of a royal burial, of someone who lived all that time ago, and to be confronted with that. Yet in almost every other area of our lives, we things fall away and decay and disappear. That's something that leaves us totally transfixed. Nevertheless, the finding of the tomb was the climax of years of looking. Tutankhamun was known about, but he was a really ephemeral king. So let's just put him into historical context. Tutankhamun came at the end of the 18th dynasty. He wasn't the last king of the 18th dynasty, but he was the last blood dynastic descendant that we know of in the 18th dynasty. It was a long and illustrious dynasty, but it was also a dynasty that had built its wealth on the systematic exploitation of its people and also of prisoners of war and people in other nations. So let's not beat about the bush. And I mentioned that before, but that is typical for the era. It's not easy or right for us to judge that. That's how they lived in those days. Everybody participated in that sort of existence. And if you were an ordinary person that day, you were likely to see your king as the bastion between yourself and the forces of chaos. But the dynasty had been around for a long time. Tutankhamun came just after the reign of the heretic pharaoh Akhenaten with his queen Nefertiti. Now, that is the dominant topic of the 18th dynasty today. Akhenaten's literature about Akhenaten, research into Akhenaten, overwhelms all other aspects of the 18th dynasty. Hatshepsut perhaps coming a second, but somewhat in the distance, I have to say, behind Akhenaten. And the irony of that, of course, is that nothing like as much is known about Akhenaten as people would like to know. And it is amazing, actually, when you read all the stuff, to realise how little the subject has moved on, how often the same controversies, they just linger because the evidence doesn't exist to resolve them. And this is even more true of Tutankhamun. So, actually, back in the early 20th century, a pit was found in the Valley of the Kings by, I suppose you could call him a hobbyist Egyptologist called Theodore Davis, a wealthy man who funded a lot of searches in the Valley of the Kings. And he believed he'd found the tomb of Tutankhamun. It was a very scrappy pit with various bits and pieces and remains of embalming materials and some other objects. And actually, he hadn't found the tomb of Tutankhamun. What he had found was a pit dug after the second robbery of of Tutankhamun's tomb, which had involved the clearance of some material from the corridor of the tomb and redeposited. But I'll come back to that later. Now, that provoked Gaston Maspero, who was a major Egyptologist at the time, to write this, which is his note about the life and reign of Tutankhamun. He tried to piece together the evidence that they had at the time. And his first sentence is, very little is known about the origin of this king. I wish I could say the situation was completely different today, but it really isn't. What we know about Tutankhamun is that he came to the throne very young, at about 8 or 9 years old. And we know that he died around the 9th year of his reign, or a little bit later. Now, one has to be very careful with that, because the 9th regnal year is the highest one attested in his tomb. That, of course, is a terminus post quem, which means it's the time after which he died. It doesn't tell you that he died then, but it's actually quite surprising in Egyptology how often these dates are taken as being fixed. Now, the terminus post quem thing doesn't seem to be understood by everybody. However, in Tutankhamun's case, because we have his body, and it definitely is his body, unlike almost all the other bodies from this period, it really is absolutely and unequivocally his body, we know he died in very young adulthood. So that helps us to piece together the basics. We know that he acceded to the throne in the immediate aftermath of Akhenaten's reign. And the reason we know that is that his birth name was Tutankhamun, and he was married initially to Ankhesenpaaten, who was Akhenaten's third daughter. They were both to change their names to Tutankhamun and Ankhesenamun. So their names, initially Tutankhamun, Ankhesenpaaten, then they become Amun-based names, and that marks the transition to the post-Amarna phase. Where was he born? No idea. Who were his parents? Now, that's one of the great controversies that is just never going to go away. Tutankhamun never tells us who his parents were, nor does he ever unequivocally appear as a prince depicted on any reliefs in the Akhenaten period. That's not unusual. Throughout the whole 18th dynasty, princes go virtually unmentioned. It's only ever the daughters who are highlighted. This is possibly in connection with trying to avoid feuding between brothers at the time of accession, we don't know. All we do know is that in the 19th dynasty and later, the son and heir is always flagged up in a way that just never had happened before. There is one relief from Hermopolis, which is a settlement across the Nile from Akhenaten city at Akhetaten, known today as Tel El Amarna, which refers to Tutankhamun as the son of the king. I wish that resolved it. That sort of phrase is a rhetorical phrase. It's difficult to know how literal it is. Tutankhamun himself never goes back to his parentage, and that is even more interesting in connection with his mother, because most of the predecessor kings had made very big deals of their mothers. If you go back to Hatshepsut, who had declared herself king, the queen who declared herself king, she had done that very successfully, but the successor kings did not want a widow queen to declare herself king again. Hatshepsut's brother, half-brother, Thutmose II, had died. That's when Hatshepsut made herself king, along with her half-nephew Thutmose III, and ruled alongside him. After her reign, her memory was damned, a lot of her monuments were destroyed, and so what the subsequent kings did was that they kept their wives very much in the background. You don't hear about them until they died, and then their son becomes king, and he makes his mother his great royal wife. She takes on the role of the queen, even if the king himself is actually married to another woman. This prevents the queen becoming king because there is securely a king already in place. That all changes under Amenhotep III when his wife Ti becomes extraordinarily prominent, but she never attempts to become king. Under Akhenaten, Nefertiti had been even more prominent, and what we know is that towards the end of the reign, Nefertiti becomes king alongside Akhenaten and possibly reigning for a little bit afterwards. There is also the shadowy figure Smenkhare. I'm not going to go into that in this talk. It's an impossible subject. You could talk about it for 10 hours and get nowhere. In fact, you could talk about it for 100 years, as Egyptologists have been talking about it, and still got nowhere. So let's set that aside to one side for the moment. There are a couple of objects, several heirloom objects, actually, in the tomb of Tutankhamun that refer to Akhenaten and Nefertiti as joint kings, along with Meriatatin, their eldest daughter, as their great royal wife. That's a strip of wood, for example, off a box. So there are pieces in the tomb that suggests that there's somehow some connection between Tutankhamun and them. Tutankhamun refers to Amenhotep III as his father on a couple of granite lions from Solib in Nubia. They're in the British Museum, actually. But again, that isn't necessarily a literal statement, although in the past some people assumed that Tutankhamun was Amenhotep III's son. But that's quite difficult to ally with Amenhotep III's apparent age and his wife Queen Ti's age. There is a surveying instrument found in an unknown location in which Tutankhamun refers to Thutmose IV as being one of his forefathers. Again, it's not explicit what the precise relationship is. Egyptian doesn't have words for grandfather or grandmother or great-grandfather, so they didn't think in the way that we do about precise family relationships, and that makes you wonder whether, in fact, they were that important to them, and therefore the symbolic connection is more important. What is evidently true is that Tutankhamun considered himself to be a member of the family dynasty. And we know from his body it had the characteristic overbite, the congenital overbite, which features in a number of the earlier bodies found in the great royal mummy caches. So there's every likelihood that he was. There's also one other very important clue. In his tomb was found a little lock of Queen Ti's hair in a little mummiform coffin. Now, that was something that... He doesn't say that Ti is his relative, but the fact that it's in the tomb, and it doesn't matter whether that hair can be tied up to the mummy known as the elder lady or not, because that's almost by the by. The fact is the hair is specifically identified as being Queen Ti's. And the only possible reason for having it there is that Tutankhamun was related to her. Now, that's only to be expected, but how closely related to her she is, that's simply impossible to say. We don't know. There's been all this DNA evidence recently, just over a decade ago, but that's proved to be terribly controversial because most of the mummies investigated, their identities are not certain. there have been, I'm not going to go into the DNA here because it is such a controversial subject and extraordinarily complicated that I couldn't possibly explain it in this, but there are a few principles that we can bear in mind. DNA does not identify bodies, and this seems to be one of the greatest mistakes people make when considering DNA. It identifies close relationships. The problem with the Egyptian royal family is that we know that there were consanguineous relationships, a lot of sibling marriages and cousin marriages, and while those are by no means comprehensive, it doesn't happen all the time, but we know of a number that did. In a situation like that, it means that the DNA overlaps, coincidences, are going to be of a completely different order from those that you would find in, say, the population in this country today, because that kind of thing doesn't really happen. And but it did happen to some extent, even in the English royal family, if you go back several hundred years. If you go back to Edward III, who ruled in the 14th century, by 150 years after his death in 1377, he had over 300 attested descendants. And during the 15th century, a number of the most important of those had been the principal protagonists of the Wars of the Roses, which was essentially fighting over the crown as descendants of Edward III. It's even known as the Cousins' War by some, precisely because they were also closely related. Within a couple of hundred years, he had several thousand descendants. Now, by the time Tutankhamun lived, the 18th dynasty had been around for a couple of hundred years. It is inconceivable that we will ever know the extent of the strands of descent and cousin relationships throughout the royal family and the nobility of Egypt at that time. It is going to be impossible for us to unravel. But you can say as a general principle that by the time Tutankhamun lived, it is very likely that there were several hundred descendants of the original royal family at the beginning of the 18th dynasty, all connected in some way, about whom we generally know nothing. But we can accept that as a legitimate possibility. That means from a DNA point of view, it is almost impossible to know. So let's have a look at Tutankhamun himself then. What did Tutankhamun think? Where did he picture himself? Well, I think on the balance of probability, and it is no more than that, he's likely to have been a son of Akhenaten, either by Nefertiti or by a lesser queen. Now, there is nothing to support that. We'll never know. But I think we can safely say that Tutankhamun regarded himself as a key member of the royal family. He was certainly depicted as one. And the fact that there are ceilings bearing his name in the mysterious tomb, KV55, very close to his own tomb, as it turned out, where Queen Ti had clearly been buried temporarily after having been brought from Amarna, and it would also appear from the magic bricks of Akhenaten that he had been brought there too. That does not mean that I am saying the body that was in KV55 was Akhenaten's. That's a whole separate issue. We know that that body was related to Tutankhamun. They shared a rare sub-blood group, and they were physically very similar. That doesn't answer the question for us. We know that Queen Ti's body was taken away, relocated. It is also possible that the mysterious younger lady, who some people believe was Nefertiti, was there too, because she ended up next to the body of the elder lady, identified by some as Queen Ti's, and they were both buried in the tomb of Amenhotep II in one of the great mummy caches. But I'm not going to sit here and tell you anything definitive about this. It is impossible to say, I've used the phrase before, the evidence does not exist to resolve the issue. But the historical fact is that Tutankhamun became king. And that KV55 tomb deposit, because of his seals, suggests that he was at least partly responsible, gave the go-ahead for the relocation of key royal family burials to be relocated from Amarna to Thebes, and thus somehow restore them to the fold, which is what he was presiding over. Whoever was behind Tutankhamun's accession to the throne, we do not know. There is circumstantial evidence to suggest that maybe the widowed Nefertiti, with her name Neferneferuaten Nefertiti and her throne name Ankheperu Re, or Anketkheperu Re, the female version of that name, mostly used by her, whether she had presided over it. We do not know. If that was the case, the evidence has not survived. But Tutankhamun's accession at the time with the name Tutankhamun, that is, he became king. We know that he seems to have ruled from Memphis to begin with, although there is actually a relief from Akhetaten, which shows him as Tutankhamun, worshipping Amun and Mut very, very early on in the reign. So he's already presiding over restoring to the fold Amun, the worship of Amun, but probably under the supervision of elders, court officials, perhaps Nefertiti, turning the clock back. Although, of course, it is quite difficult to see why Nefertiti would have done that, given how integral a part she'd been to the Aten revolution. Nevertheless, there it is. Tutankhamun has become king, along with Ankhes and Amun. What happened to the rest of Akhenaten's daughters, we don't know. We know that Mekhetaten had died much earlier on during Akhenaten's reign. The rest, including Meriataten, they just disappear. Gone. Forgotten. That's it. Apart from the heirloom items that ended up in Tutankhamun's tomb, there is actually a palette of Mekhetaten's which is in a museum now. It wasn't actually catalogued as being in Tutankhamun's tomb, but appears probably to have originated from that at the time. Anyway, it would be lovely for me to sit here and tell you then what had happened during the 9 years or so of Tutankhamun's reign. We don't know. There is no narrative. There's no chronology. You might have thought that Tutankhamun's tomb would have elaborated on that, provided all sorts of information about his achievements, the decisions that he made. No idea whatsoever. There simply wasn't any information in the tomb. And that's why the historical story of Tutankhamun hasn't really changed very much. If you go back all the way to the beginning of the 18th dynasty, there was a soldier called Ames, son of Ibana. And he considered himself to be a seriously big deal. He took part in the wars of the first three pharaohs of the 18th dynasty, depicts himself in his tomb biography as the epicentre of the fighting, the greatest military achiever of the time, of having the sole focus of the king's admiration, in constant receipt of rewards, and he itemises the wars at the time that he took part in. It's obviously a hopelessly biased source of information. But the occasional snippets of other evidence suggest that it's broadly based on a plausible series of events that really did happen, even if Ames, son of Ibana, has grossly exaggerated his role. And, for example, in the wars, there's never any mention of Egyptian mistakes or defeats or setbacks. It's all a cavalcade of glory and his magnificent achievements, basking in the king's undying admiration. There is no such record for Tutankhamun's reign, or indeed Akhenaten's, and that's why we simply don't know what happened during the 9 years, apart from the fact that Akhenaten's revolution is starting to be undone. So, we see the restoration of Amun. Tutankhamun makes a huge big deal about this. There is a restoration stela in his name, which recounts how the temples had fallen into rack and ruin. Of course, that's unlikely they'd fall into rack and ruin in the space of only 16 or 17 years, or maybe 20 years at most. But, of course, in the Egyptian rhetorical self-glorification, you always have to paint what you're repairing, what you're doing in the worst possible light so that your achievements look much better. So he doubles, trebles, quadruples the gifts and honours to the temples. He brings it all back. It's all in that stela. And, of course, that's what we see is the city of Akhetaten is gradually turning back into desert as the buildings are taken down, valuables removed and so on. It just becomes a sand-blown ghost town eventually. So there's that. Tutankhamun's reign is therefore, apart from that, something a very shadowy period. There are depictions of Tutankhamun going to war. There's the famous box from his tomb that shows him riding in a chariot and fighting, firing arrows at his enemies. And the tomb is indeed filled with arrows and weaponry like that, and his walking sticks. And along with the chariots that have been used, it indicates that certainly Tutankhamun was interested in that sort of thing. But it is impossible in Egypt to look at a monument like that, like the box, or even the fragmentary reliefs which have been found, reused in other buildings, which probably originated from Tutankhamun. Mortuary temple, very quickly dismantled after his reign, that show him going to war. These are wars that probably took place against rising Hittite power, but Horemheb, who was to become pharaoh next reign but one, he was the general presiding over these wars and memorialised them in his own tomb. While he undoubtedly took part and led these wars, whether Tutankhamun ever participated is another matter. But I think one does have to be slightly careful about this. You are looking at a very different time. Tutankhamun's accession to the throne as a child was very definitely a vulnerable thing to have happened to Egypt, but he was by far and away not unusual. Because many of the kings of the 18th dynasty had come to the throne as children or very young adults. So this was an ongoing thing. So you might have thought that perhaps having Tutankhamun in power, you couldn't possibly risk him losing his life. You would have to preserve him at all costs, at least those with the interest in doing so, against factional rivals, that sort of thing. But that hadn't happened in the past. So perhaps no particular reason to assume it was going to happen under Tutankhamun. I think it's also worth considering somebody like Edward VI of England. Edward VI of England was a king who ruled for around the same sort of age, at the same sort of age as Tutankhamun. He was highly educated, a very powerful force in promoting the Protestant cause in Reformation England, highly articulate in how he expressed his views about that. Now, we have no way of knowing whether Tutankhamun was as intelligent or whether he was as well educated, but Edward VI proves that you cannot assume that a child king is totally ineffectual. It is conceivable that Tutankhamun was an able child, able young man, who expressed his own views and did participate to some extent, even driving some of what was going on in Egypt. But nothing could alter the fact that we know from his body that he was physically quite vulnerable. And that is a key part of what was going to happen and decide future events. Now, he was married to Ankhesenamun, as I've already mentioned. Tutankhamun, unlike those previous child kings, was not going to live long enough to father an heir, at least one who had had time to grow up. We know, or we think we know, from the fact that there were two miscarried fetuses in the tomb, that he and his wife had had at least two pregnancies. And the DNA investigation of that, again, it's very complicated, and there's lots of arguments about their origins. But I think you can fairly say from the DNA evidence that it's reasonable to assume that they were certainly members of the royal family. But at least one had congenital deformities, the fact that they'd miscarried, the fact that Tutankhamun and Ankhesenamun may have been half-siblings, and even if they weren't half-siblings or full siblings, they were almost certainly cousins, and the product of multiple cousin marriages, and so therefore, while that by no means guaranteed that the children would have things wrong with them and not be able to live, not be viable, it's quite conceivable. It's certainly much more likely in their case than it would be for a normal marriage where there was no genetic relationship at all. So one has to accept that. I think it's reasonable to assume that senior officials in the court of Tutankhamun, and we know of some of them, there's I, who was going to succeed Tutankhamun as king. A very senior official who'd already been a senior official under Akhenaten had done that remarkable thing of bridging the gap between two totally different regimes and managed to survive in a position of huge influence. There was Meir, the treasurer. They both were men who had had obviously a huge amount of influence during the reign of Tutankhamun. They must have looked at this boy with some concern. The stakes were enormous. If Tutankhamun died young, and they probably suspected that that was a possibility, the whole edifice risked falling apart. As far as we know, there were no other obvious members of the dynasty who could have succeeded to the throne at a useful age or with useful experience had Tutankhamun died. We know that Horemheb was labelled as the hereditary prince. That's a very bad translation, which also means senior noble. But that could have indicated that Horemheb was the stand-in heir were Tutankhamun to die young. We know from Tutankhamun's body, which, as I mentioned earlier, is indisputably his body, that he had a strange shape. He had very wide hips. He had a pigeon chest. He exhibited some of the physical signs of Akhenaten, which suggests him there's a better chance than even that he was a very close relative of Akhenaten's. We know that he had hypophalangism. We also know he had a club foot. We also know that he had malaria. And we also know that he'd fractured one of his legs. The collective picture of Tutankhamun when he died is of somebody who was not an especially well person. Now, of course, that did not guarantee that he was going to die young, but it made it a little bit more likely. And it's possible that the fracture, which may well have happened while he was out riding in a chariot, just the sort of situation in which it could, that may have tipped the balance. Somebody with a weakened constitution, the lack of an ability to deal with serious infection at the time, all the circumstances, the weakening caused by malaria, for example, all of that could have meant that Tutankhamun was going to succumb. And the fact is that he did succumb. He died. There's no evidence that he was murdered. The old idea that the hole in the back of his head was caused by somebody giving him a thump to bump him off. No, that was to do with the mummification process. What we do know from the tomb, though, is that it appears to have been extremely hurried. There's a huge amount of evidence from the tomb to suggest that the entire deposit was thrown together. He wasn't even buried in a proper royal tomb. Now, the tomb designated for Tutankhamun was probably one in the Western Valley of the Kings. And the Western Valley of the Kings, which is not very far away, was not widely used, but it had been used towards the end of the 18th dynasty. Amenhotep III, for example, had been buried there. I was going to end up being buried in the tomb probably designated for Tutankhamun. Tutankhamun was buried in a small tomb in the Valley of the Kings, which was initially just a corridor and a single room, and it had to be rapidly extended. So there is the antechamber here, and I'm going to look at it from your point of view. So there is the antechamber, and there was the annex, a little room was then added there, and then to the left here was the burial chamber, and beyond that, the treasury. So that's all bolted on to the antechamber, which is what the original tomb would have been. It's simply not big enough. And the result is that the tomb was extremely cluttered. Digging it out was obviously a bit of a rush job. And then one of the first things that had to go in was the stone sarcophagus. And the stone sarcophagus, it's quite obvious from the carvings on it that it's been adapted from somebody else's. But there's nothing left on the sarcophagus to tell you whose it was. But it's been quite extensively changed. The coffins that were put together for Tutankhamun, no one thought to measure them. So when they put Tutankhamun in his three coffins, the second one of which many people will tell you belonged to somebody else, not Tutankhamun, that's based on the facial features. I don't really go along with that. Actually, if you look at the face and line it up photographically with the others, it's not really that different. And in any case, I'm rather dubious about the extent to which you can make facial identifications from these things. They were produced in royal workshops for members of the royal family by people who were churning out the same stuff. They don't differ that much. And therefore, actually, it's quite possible these things were often designated to be used by anyone in the royal family who needed it at the time. They're a bit generic, is what I'm trying to say. It's not clear, especially as it's quite obvious some of the things had had their names adapted. Anyway, back to the coffins. So the three coffins go in with Tutankhamun inside, and then they discover that the feet of the outer coffin are sticking out, so that they just hack it off with an adze. And the reason they found out that it didn't fit was when they put the sarcophagus lid on, it had cracked over the feet. So not only did they have to hack off the end of the feet, they also have to repair the sarcophagus lid. That's the first series of problems. Various other things go wrong in the tomb when the wooden shrines are assembled around the tomb. They're put in incorrectly. The instructions aren't followed, so somebody just brings along a hammer and they whack them and make them fit. At least one of the shrines had belonged to somebody else originally. The names have been changed on that. If you go through to the treasury, there's a little shrine which contains the canopic jars with Tutankhamun's viscera inside them. The four goddesses outside have been misplaced. There's a whole pile of wood shavings left next to it by some of the carpenters. They haven't even bothered to clear that up. The calcite jars, which had been brought in with unguents for the tomb, many of them were old, broken, repaired. They've clearly been dragged off the palace inventory to use in the tomb. There are various other objects that have been thrown in. Oh, before I forget, the canopic jars, the little mummiform coffins. It's quite obvious the names in some of them have been changed. There are those who will tell you that some of the funerary equipment looks very much as if it had been originally designated for Nefertiti. And that includes some of the little statuettes which appear to be women but have had their names changed to Tutankhamun. There is the appearance of the name Ankheperure, or apparently Ankheperure, which was Nefertiti's throne name. Also the throne name of Smenkhare, the mystery figure who might have ruled with Anka Akhenaten as a co-regent. But in fact, Smenkhare's name never appears in the tomb. Just as Smenkhare's name never appears in Tomb 55, it never appears in Tutankhamun's tomb. So he remains as much of a mystery as ever. If some of the equipment was Nefertiti's, it suggests that her royal burial had been dismantled if she'd ever had one. There are some people who believe that Nefertiti is buried in a hidden chamber beyond the end of Tutankhamun's tomb. Well, if you can believe that if you want. Absolutely no scientific investigation has thrown up any evidence of that whatsoever. And I do think it's a fairly misguided piece of wishful thinking. But anyway, there we are. That sort of theories about hidden bedded treasure have always abounded in Egypt. However, so Tutankhamun's tomb, it is thrown together, and eventually, his successor king, who's managed to, we don't know how he worked it. The whole issue of what happened after Tutankhamun's death is another extraordinarily controversial period involving documents from the Hittite world about whether Ankhesenamun had tried to get a son, well, I say Ankhesenamun, a queen of Egypt had tried to get a Hittite prince to be sent over as a substitute king. That's another story. I'm not going to go into that here. I might discuss that in another talk. What matters is the tomb. The tomb itself of Tutankhamun was eventually finished and sealed. It had a long corridor running down into it. What we know from the remains of the tomb is that it was robbed quite shortly afterwards. And the robbers really didn't get very far at that stage. This is probably when they decanted some of the unguents and made off with some easily portable items. And, you know, the incredible thing about tomb robbing, especially in Tutankhamun's tomb, you know, it's impossible to stand in the Valley of the Kings anywhere without someone up on the cliffs looking down on you. The idea that people, you know, the burial place was secret, and forget that. The entire event of the funerary procession, the stuff being brought down, and carried into the tomb, everybody in the area will have known where Tutankhamun's tomb was and what was in it, especially as it carried on being filled long after Tutankhamun himself had been installed in there. You can tell that from the layout of the tomb. So, obviously, the locals knew the stuff was in there. And you couldn't possibly have dug down into it without somebody noticing, so there had to be a certain amount of complicity in all of this. Anyway, after the first robbery was discovered, the corridor was filled up with rubble to stop people getting in, and that involved removing some of the material that had been left in there into a pit a few hundred yards away in the Valley of the Kings, and that was the one that Theodore Davis had found some years before. And even after that, the tomb was still broken into yet again. This time the robbers had not only to dig down through the filled stairwell, but also down through the corridor that was filled with rubble to get in. They got as far as starting to open the shrines, and if they got in, they would have ripped out Tutankhamun's mummy and got themselves the gold coffin and the mask. That didn't happen. They seem to have been apprehended, and the tomb was presumably punished or even executed. The tomb was resealed, and it was not visited again until Howard Carter found it in 1922. And the reason for that probably is that because it's right down in the middle of the bottom of the Valley of the Kings, any kind of flash flood, which does happen there from time to time, would have covered the entrance very deeply with flood debris, made it impossible for anybody to dig there without, you know, a major industrial effort to get down. Plus, the tomb of Ramesses VI was built sometime later, just a few yards away, and at that stage, workmen's huts were built over, unknowingly, over the entrance to Tutankhamun's tomb. So that was the end of that. And there we have the end of Tutankhamun from history. So with Tutankhamun dead and buried, after his reign of 8-9 years, something like that, what had he achieved that we know about? We know that he'd brought back the primacy of Amun. We know that Artanism had largely disappeared. And it's quite interesting that in the tomb there are a number of items that still bear the name of the Aten. Tutankhamun's throne that was found in the tomb has Tutankhamun on the back of the throne, but on the sides, Tutankhaten. That is still there. Hadn't bothered to change it. This kind of covering up of Artanism, that's fairly piecemeal, haphazard. It isn't comprehensive. So you can't imagine that there was a wholesale campaign to crush it. He was apparently quite prepared to sit on a throne that still had the Aten's name on it. And let's not forget that Aten was a legitimate god, a part of the Egyptian pantheon. So perfectly reasonable in a way to preserve its existence as a subsidiary member of the wider range of Egyptian gods. He'd done that. There'd been a certain amount of work to put the temples back into order. Whether he fought any wars himself, as I've mentioned already, not very likely, but there certainly was fighting going on against Asiatic enemies, according to Horemheb. And that's it. The tragedy, of course, is that Tutankhamun's death left Egypt in an extremely tight corner. He does represent the end of the known bloodline of the 18th dynasty, and that was a very serious situation indeed for the country and for the royal family, what was left of it. What happened to Ankhesenamun? That is another story, and not for this talk. Actually, we don't know what happened to her, but it's possible, as I've just mentioned, that she was the one who sought a Hittite prince to replace her. That's something I'll come back to if I have an opportunity to in another talk. So with Tutankhamun dead and buried, where did that leave Egypt? In a tight corner. He was the last definitively known blood member of the royal dynasty. And I think that's why I, this senior official, has stepped in, even as an old man, to make himself king. It was the only possible way at the time of restoring any reliable stability at that point. By not leaving an heir, Tutankhamun had changed the course of history. Throughout the 18th dynasty, there had always been someone on hand from the family to succeed to the throne. And that's all changed. Egypt is potentially really quite vulnerable. Now, of course, I wasn't the only possible candidate, and Horemheb was to become king after I was another obvious one. There may have been other people about whom we know absolutely nothing. Tutankhamun's achievements, frankly, are a little opaque to us. Yes, he may well have restored Amun. We know that happened. We know that Artanism remained visible. His throne, for example, found in the tomb, has his name Tutankhamun on the back. It has Tutankhaten on the side, Tutankhaten, depending on how you want to pronounce it. That hadn't been changed. There are other objects in the tomb where the name of the Aten subsists. Clearly there was no need felt to be absolutely comprehensive about getting rid of the Aten. And that may reflect the fact that Aten was a perfectly legitimate member of the wider Egyptian pantheon of gods. There was no special reason to get rid of it wholesale. But it simply may not have been that important as we think it might have been. Nevertheless, I becomes king. Now, the immediate aftermath, as I alluded to before, which involves Ankhesenamun, possibly Ankhesenamun, looking for a Hittite prince. Hopefully I will return to that in another talk. It's actually a very interesting subject, that. Very controversial, and it may not have been her, but as I say, that's another story. But the fact is that I became king, and we don't hear of Ankhesenamun ever again. He usurps some of Tutankhamun's monuments immediately. That's some of Tutankhamun's statues, and also apparently his mortuary temple, memorial temple and mortuary temple in western Thebes. He only reigns for 3 to 4 years, and then Horemheb, about whom there's another talk on this channel, takes over. And it's Horemheb who is perhaps the prime mover in usurping as many of Tutankhamun's monuments as possible. And if you go to the Temple of Luxor today, or Karnak, you will see that there are a small number of youthful-looking statues in the building, still where they were originally, and those are obviously Tutankhamun, but they've got the names of later kings on them, and you can just tell from the youthfulness that it's Tutankhamun. So there's Tutankhamun. Had it not been for the tomb, we would have very little to say about Tutankhamun in general, there was and remains very little to say about the events of Tutankhamun's reign, about which we know next to nothing. But nothing is ever going to supplant the fact that Tutankhamun's tomb yielded objects which give us the visual realization of what it was like to live as a king in that period of time. It represents the fabulous inequality of wealth. Absolutely typical for that period of time. But I think the chaos and disorder in the tomb and the mistakes made in putting it together, I think that tells us something really quite interesting about Egypt. You can take at face value the spells and the magic and the inscriptions, and you can talk about the extraordinary veneration the Egyptians had for the dead, particularly for dead kings, the massive importance of the symbolism of how the king was buried, what he was buried with, the meaning of the arcane, complex inscriptions and their references to where Tutankhamun was going to go when he died, the whole myth of that rebirth of kingship in the afterlife and the transference of kingship to the successor, which I had been so keen to show in the paintings on the wall of the burial chamber. Unprecedented, actually, to have a successor like that shown in that way. But with so many mistakes being made in the tomb, you do have to wonder how much this mattered to Egyptians in the way we sometimes imagine, and certainly not to the people putting it together. The workmen, for example, were probably not very literate. This would explain why the three ceremonial beds in the antechamber seem to have been partially misassembled. They're slightly mixed up between the parts. The fact that the goddesses on the canopic jar shrine for Tutankhamun's viscera, the fact that they were mixed up, these and the mistakes in the shrines would have meant that the magic, technically, didn't work, couldn't have worked, had been completely ruined by misassembling it. And you would have thought that perhaps somebody must have been there to supervise it, to make sure this was done properly. Apparently not so. And if we find the Egyptians incredibly confusing, in the course of writing this book, I've often wondered whether actually the people most confused by the Egyptians were the Egyptians themselves, that so complex was the symbolism of their world, they weren't entirely sure how to handle it themselves, quite how to get it right, what it all really meant. So you therefore have this interesting picture of this blundering assembly of a tomb filled with things of massive potency and wealth and importance to their culture. The apogee of artistic achievement. I mean, the gold mask, the gold coffin, absolutely staggering pieces of work. But even the throne had lattice work around the seat, all completely broken off, presumably because it was sat on by Tutankhamun as a small child, and his ankles battering against it, breaking it off. And that seems to be the case with more than one chair in his tomb. Still put into the tomb like that broken second-hand furniture. And this is, I think, an insight, if you like, to the humanity of the Egyptians. In many ways, ordinary people like ourselves, however complex the symbolism and religious world in which they lived, they just, you know, battered their way through it, fudged it, as people so often do. And then the fact that so many people were quite prepared to participate in the tomb robbing exercise shows you that whatever the significance of all of it, it clearly didn't matter to these people who were perfectly happy to climb down into the tomb and nick what they could, and they could not possibly have done it without the complicity of others. Had they had their way, the tomb would have been completely emptied out, and we would know even less about Tutankhamun's culture. But there we are. That's all I can say about Tutankhamun. He came, lived a short, wholly, as far as we know, unexceptional life, but left us with something so pricelessly important in terms of thinking about our own mortality, the shortness of our own lives, being confronted with that, to be able to look at things in a tomb that bear on them, like the grease on the chariot axles, bear on them the evidence of a life lived. And perhaps there's nothing that symbolises him more than the reed, which was cut into a made into a walking stick for Tutankhamun, which bears an inscription saying it had been cut by the king himself when he was out one day by the river. That, to me, takes us back 33 centuries in an instant, and no one will ever get past that. No one will ever be able to beat that in archaeological terms.